Welcome as we gather to celebrate the fourth Sunday of Advent. We at St. Basil's regard the love of God to be the foundation of all life and ministry. We believe in the ever-present love of God as witnessed through Christ and empowered by the Holy Spirit. We believe that each person is loved by God and is of sacred worth. Therefore, through God's grace, we welcome all persons to our parish. We expressed God's hospitality by creating a safe, healing, accessible, and transforming place for all to enter. Further, we acknowledge with gratitude and respect that we gather here on the unceded and unsurrendered territory of the Algonquin Nation, whose presence here reaches back to time immemorial. We honor their long history of welcoming many nations to this beautiful territory, and we uphold and uplift the voice and values of our host nation. Relationship is at the core of today's gospel. Mary travels to be with her cousin Elizabeth. There is a visceral, tangible reaction when the two women embrace. Part of this encounter highlights the significance of the familial relationship between Mary and Elizabeth, where the two offer each other support and solidarity. Even more fundamental, however, is Mary's and Elizabeth's relationship with God. Do we recognize God in our relationships? In addition to your own personal intentions, please remember the Mass intention is for Elizabeth Roy, requested by Constance O'Donnell. Our presider this evening is Father Winkler. Please stand.
Listen, my people, your hopes are answered. Listen and hear my voice, your hopes are answered. Your hopes are for all people to throw off the dark of night and to welcome the new day where all is light. Listen, my people, your hopes are answered.
We've gathered this evening in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Today we celebrate the fourth Sunday of Advent, so we're going to light the last candle on our wreath. Lord, our God, we praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is Emmanuel, the hope of all the peoples. He is the wisdom that teaches and guides us, and he is the Savior of every nation. Lord God, let your blessing come upon us as we light the candles of this wreath. May the wreath and its light be a sign of Christ's promise to bring salvation. May he come quickly and not delay. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
You are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christ Jesus, you are so Son of the Holy Virgin Mary, Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Lord Jesus, you are Word made flesh, splendor of the Father. Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech you, O Lord, your grace into our hearts, that we, to whom the incarnation of Christ, your Son, was made known by the message of an angel, may, by his passion and his cross, be brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Micah. The Lord says to his people, "You, O Bethlehem of Ephraimah, who are one of the little clans of Judea, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore, he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the children of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be peace." The word of the Lord.
God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us, and we shall be saved. O shepherd of Israel, hear us. Shine forth from your cherubim throne. O Lord, rouse up your might. O Lord, come to our help. God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us, and we shall be saved. God of hosts, turn again, we implore. Look down from heaven and see. Visit the vine and protect it, the vine your right hand has planted.
God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us, and we
you have given your strength, and we shall never forsake you again. Give us life that we may call upon your name. God of hosts, bring us back. Let your face shine on us, and we shall be saved.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "As it is written of me in the scroll of the book, see, God, I have come to do your will, O God." When Christ said, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings. These are offered according to the law." Then he added, "See, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sacrificed through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The word of the Lord.
With you, a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Mary set out, and she went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah, and she greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." My brothers and sisters, the gospel of the Lord. So tonight we celebrate the fourth Sunday of Advent, and I guess the part of the theme, I never got these right. I guess this weekend, the fourth weekend, is peace. We're celebrating peace, or the theme is peace, and we get some of that in the first reading today. But what I have been doing recently, my mind has been, I don't want to use the word preoccupied, but busied about certain themes. And one of them has been the Synod, thinking a lot about the Synod and how we are going to experience it in our parish. Very excited about it. And many parishioners are also excited about being able to have a voice in what takes place in the Synod of Bishops that will happen in Rome in 2023. So the Pope wants to hear you. He wants to hear me. He wants to hear how we experience the church in our lives. He wants to hear especially all the documents, and this has been a big theme of his since he became Pope in 2013, is I want to hear the voices on the outskirts. I get enough of cardinals and bishops talking to me all the time. You know, and I hear a certain voice from them, but I'm more concerned about those way out there and those way over there. I want to hear what they say too. I want to hear from those who are marginalized. How do they feel? You know, I want to hear from the ennui, the poor. How does it feel to be in your church? What does it feel like? It's not because he's glorifying these positions, you know, the marginalized, those on the periphery, those not excluded, those who are excluded, those who don't feel welcome. These are the voices he wants to really hear. And it's not because that he's glorifying it. He's saying it shouldn't exist. There shouldn't be marginalized people way out there. There shouldn't be poor people. There's not supposed to be people who feel excluded. That's human sinfulness that has entered the picture. And part of this today, while we're talking about peace, is how do we create peace? Because it begins with us. That's not God's plan, that there is poor people, that there are marginalized, that there are those who I feel broken by the church. That was never God's plan. It wasn't the plan of the gospel. It certainly wasn't Jesus's plan, though he encountered those who didn't mind if there were marginalized people, or those who were people who didn't mind if they were excluded. He called them Pharisees. And the Pharisee party, the Pharisees in our church, they exist today too. They've been with us all this while. So on this Sunday, let us reflect on the gospel and the readings. The first reading comes from the book of the prophet Micah, and already we can say he's marginalized a little bit because he's considered the minor prophets, not the major ones. The major ones are Isaiah and Ezekiel and Jeremiah. Those are the grand prophets of the Old Testament. Micah is just a minor one, although we hear from his voice three times a year in the course of our lectionary, and we hear from him tonight. And someone who may feel marginalized also may come from a small town, and as he does. And he says, he's preaching his words of prophecy. And this is what a prophet does. The first thing they do is they have an experience of the vision of the Lord. They've had an experience in their life that is in sync with the vision that God gives them. So they speak from experience. We see that today with Elizabeth. She's speaking from experience. But Micah speaks from experience, from someone who has felt marginalized from the system. And his prophecy is this: Bethlehem, you're a small town. You're insignificant. You don't matter much to Jerusalem. But behold, from you will come the King. It's from you that God will work his salvation. And that's how it always seems to be, that God works through the poor and the marginalized and the weak and the ones who are dependent on others for their lives. Isn't it ironic that God chooses the weak to do his work? And if you start from the book of Genesis and you go to the book of Revelation, that's the pattern. God often chooses people who don't seem to have the ability to do what he wants. People who refuse, who resist. I don't have that skill. I don't have that intellectual capacity. I don't speak well. That's what Jeremiah said. Isaiah said, I've got it all backwards. Don't ask me. And then he asks, a young girl, a young woman, to be the mother of the Messiah. And she does. She says, yes, but I'm skipping a bit. So this is the message of Micah, the prophet Micah, is that from this small group of insignificant people, that's from whom that group, the king and the Messiah, will come from. So that's the message in Micah today. In Hebrews, the message is, God, it's about the incarnation. God sacrificed his body once and for all. That's what Hebrews, the letter from the Hebrews says, letter to the Hebrews says tonight. That in the mystery of salvation, we usually focus on the crucifixion and rising to new life. We call that the Paschal mystery, which we celebrate every Easter. But the letter to the Hebrews says, that's not all of it. You're only getting part of the mystery. The mystery begins right here. The mystery of our salvation begins in a dump, in a space where the animals ate and did their business. And I don't want to get graphic, but it probably didn't smell very nice where Jesus was born. It probably was pretty filthy. And that's where the Messiah was born. You see this pattern of the lowly being raised up, of God's work being done from the bottom up? That's what we celebrate. Because if we celebrate, and I love that. I love that. Because I've never felt quite fit in. I never felt I'd fit in. You know, I grew up in a white area, very racist against black people in Illinois. And my mother is brown. So we didn't fit in. Everyone where I grew up was Pentecostals. We were Catholics. Don't fit in. Every time I turn around, no matter where we moved, then we left Illinois and we went to Sault Ste. Marie. Then I didn't fit in there either because I spoke with an American twang. I spoke like a, I hate to say this, I'm not putting it down, but I spoke like a hillbilly. That's my first language. And when I got to the Sault Ste. Marie, everyone said, are you an American? Every time I couldn't open my mouth without being, you know, so I never fit in. Everywhere I've been, never quite fit in. So for me, I'm sensitive to the marginalized. I'm on their side. I'm sensitive to those who don't fit in, because that's been my experience too. We've grew up in poverty, so I know what that means. All of those things. And so when I hear that God uses people like that to do his work, it encourages me, but it should encourage all of us. Because in some way, none of us fit in perfectly. We all have defects. There's something in our past that makes, it's not just me. If you look at your life, there are probably things that you don't fit in perfectly either, but God can work through you. Just like he worked through Mary. Just like he works through Micah. Just like he works through the author of Hebrews. So all of us can be sources of salvation in this world through our own care, love, and compassion, which we see so beautifully in this story today between Elizabeth and Mary. What a beautiful story it is. It's so full of hope and so full of love when these two cousins meet each other. And I know what it is. When you really love your cousin or your sister or someone in your family and you haven't seen them in a long time, what kind of a celebration it is to see them again. And here Mary and Elizabeth are greeting each other. But this time both of them have experienced miracles, real miracles in their lives because they're both pregnant. And they're both pregnant because of a miraculous occasion. Mary wasn't even married and had an experience of married life. And Elizabeth was old. She was beyond the age of bearing children, and yet both of them, God gave them gifts. And their gift is our gift, too, because it's about our healing and our salvation. They brought forth boys who grew up to be men who followed the Lord. And because they were able to do that, we were saved, especially Christ's, through his death and resurrection and his incarnation. So let us reflect on peace. That's the theme tonight, the overall theme. How can I be peace for others? How can those on the margins, how can those on the periphery also be sources of peace in this world? They can be if we open up to them and allow them to speak their voice too. Having listened to God's word, let us now profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. God our Creator, your Spirit is at work in our world. Hear the prayers we bring before you this evening.
For the Church, that the season of Advent will bring about renewed hope as we seek to live more fully in God, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis, Archbishop Danfous, and for all who share in the ministry of leadership, that they may continue to encourage the faithful to joyfully share the hope and promise of the gospel. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those suffering loss and displacement because of mudslides and floods in British Columbia, tornadoes in the U.S., typhoons in the Philippines, and other places in the world due to extreme weather conditions, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all people who find this season particularly joyless may find consolation in Emmanuel, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For civic and political leaders, that they may cooperatively pursue development which is moral, sustainable, and attentive to both the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a spirituality of journeying together, that we may be formed as disciples of Christ, as families, as communities, and as human beings, through our experience of this synodal journey, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those discerning vocations as priests, deacons, lay ministers, religious life, married life, and single life, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those among us who are sick, we pray especially for John Dorner, Marie Smith, Amanda Manette, Rita McLean Nemish, Laura and Francis Mathot, Roger Heath, Father Peter Bisson, Aidan Wurzwick, Shirley Armstrong, David Williams, Mona Dubay, Brian Mulvihill. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those whom we love and who have died, we remember especially Kay Rehill, Elizabeth Roy, Jane Knox, Brian Morey, Muriel Hart, Oral Girardi, Danny Salama, and all who have died from the coronavirus, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, hope of all the nations, you give us this holy season of Advent as a time to prepare our hearts for the wonders of your kingdom. Hear our prayers, we implore you, and keep us alert and ready for the dawning of that perfect day. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Servant of the word and maid of the Lord, blessed are you. Chosen as the Holy One, pray for us and lead us to the Son of God. Bearer of God's Son, woman of great faith, blessed
pray, my brothers and sisters, that this our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Holy Spirit, O Lord, make holy these gifts laid upon your altar, just as he filled with his power the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We ask this through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For all the oracles of the prophets foretold him. The Virgin Mother longed for him with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist sang of his coming and proclaimed his presence when he came. It is by his gift that already we rejoice at the mystery of his nativity, so that he may find us watchful in prayer and exultant in his praise. And so with angels and archangels, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things, and you make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial one by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her husband, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Basil and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Marcel, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, and we pray especially for Kay Rehill and Elizabeth Roy, Jane Knox, Brian Morey, Muriel Hart, Oral Girardi, Danny Salama, and all who have died from the coronavirus. Admit them to your kingdom, and there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on this world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Jesus taught us to call God our Father, so we all have the courage to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. And the peace of the Lord be with you always." Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. May the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Thank you.
Having received this pledge of eternal redemption, we pray, Almighty God, that as the feast day of our salvation draws ever nearer, so we may press forward all the more eagerly to the worthy celebration of the mystery of your Son's nativity, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Please be seated. We just have a few announcements.
Join us this Sunday, December 19th, at 2:30 p.m. for the third and final mini-retreat, Reflection on Anna, the Prophets, with parishioner Arlene Dolan. Zoom link is on the parish website. Please wait and follow the usher's directions for exiting. This will help to ensure we are all maintaining our safe physical distancing. And we also ask that as you exit your pew, please leave the kneeler down. This will help our custodian, Ibrahim, to know that your pew was occupied. We need your help with the delivery of the Christmas hampers this year. For those that have helped out in the past, we thank you in advance for continuing to do so. And for those who have not delivered Christmas hampers in the past, this is an ideal time to start. The hampers, gift bags, and food boxes will be available in the narthex after masses for pickup. In respecting social distancing, we don't want to cause a bottleneck in the narthex, so please be patient and wait for your chance to bring some joy to others in need. Michael Gleason would like to say a few words.
It seems during COVID, there's all kinds of new rules and everything else. Do a little presentation of how we can stay safe. First thing I want to say is thank you for your support for the food club throughout the whole year. And once again, we've had a great success in the Christmas Hamper program. Well, I can't put this on before we set up a couple more holes, put it there.
We have boxes at the back, and they have address on the side here. And what we have this year, we cut down on handling different things. On the back, there's a little tag. What the tag is, put me and your phone number. And you just take it off and take this box as you read. Going out, the single adults are on the left side, and the banners, the gifts are on the right side. And once again, please be safe in delivering it. We no longer go into apartments. They need us in the lobby. If you're not, secure going into the lobby, they lock you out. Or you can come to your vehicle. Phone number, call, make your time. Drive up, step away, let them take the gift that they want. Or if you bring it up, put it in the lobby, step away, and have social distance. And thank you for your assistance.
Just one final announcement. In the bulletin, you're going to find a section here that says Christmas Eve and Christmas Day Masses. It's full of mistakes. I don't know how we did it. Three people edit it, and still it's riddled with mistakes this year. But the website is perfect. And so is the MailChimp that I sent you. That's perfect. So the times are correct. The only thing different is we weren't going to have registrations this year. That's before Omicron variant appeared in Ontario. So we've decided yesterday that we would have registrations for the three masses, mainly so we can keep track of the number of people. Our capacity is 120. So I'm not sure if we'll ever at any of the masses make 120. But just in case, we want to register because we don't want anyone to get sick. That's for sure. We don't want anyone to get sick. So that's where we're going to ask you to register so we can keep track of the numbers. All of this will be done next week. So, but don't follow it. It's riddled with mistakes. Okay. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you during this holy Advent season. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our Eucharist has ended. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Listen, my people, your hopes are answered. Listen. For all people to open wide their eyes and to welcome the Messiah.